Hello everyone, how are you all doing? Hope you all are doing well. So, we have already made videos on the first chapter of chemistry, chemical reactions and equations. If you have not gone through it, please do check the video and here is a link for it. Alright? Yes. Now, let us start the second chapter of chemistry, which is acid, bases and salts. Yes. So, before going to this topic or this chapter in detail, let us discuss a few of the common things which we see in around us in our day-to-day life. Alright? Yes. So, have you ever thought why certain things like curd, vinegar or lemon juice or raw mangoes or unripened grapes, the tasting, you know, they're sour, right? They are sour. And few are sweet, whereas few are salty and few food materials are bitter in taste. Correct? So, what do you think? So, what substances present in them are adding them these kind of taste? Yes. So, in this chapter, we should answer to all these questions on this basis only. We have classified the compounds into acids, bases and salts. Okay, and in your day-to-day life, you have also absorbed. If a person is suffering from gastritis due to no excess of acid which is produced in stomach, people usually give a remedy as a baking soda or a antacid, which is nothing but a milk of magnesium. So, what do you think? What the property of these antacid or baking soda is making them to give for a person who is suffering from gastritis? Yes. See, the thing is, these basic soda or antacid, they are basic in nature. As you know, gastritis is caused because of excess of HCl acid, which is produced in the stomach. So, usually what happens is, these acids and bases, these are chemically opposite in nature and they will cancel out each other's effect, and it's like they will nullify each other effect. Okay, and thus a person will be relieved from his gastritis. Okay, so we shall discuss more about acid, bases, what are the characteristics of acid, what exactly acid means, and what about base and about bases and salts. We shall discuss in this chapter now. Well, so now let us discuss about acids in detail. Okay, see, the acid word has been derived from a Latin word called as acidus, which means a souring taste. Okay, so that's the reason the sour taste of vinegar is because of the presence of acidic acid. And the sour taste of lemon and most of the citrus fruits is because of the presence of citric acid. So acid basically refers to what? Souring taste. Okay, so how can we define acids? So acid is a hydrogen containing compound, so which gives free hydrogen ions or hydronium ions, because hydrogen ions cannot exist alone. So that's the reason they will combine with water molecules when dissolved in water and they will produce H3O plus ions. Nothing but this are the hydronium. Call H3O plus is what? Hydronium ions. Okay, so this is a proper definition of an acid. Okay, so it's a compound which contains hydrogen, and when you dissolve these substances in our water, it will produce H plus or H3O plus ions. It's like this. H plus ions will combine with the water molecules to produce H3O plus ions. Alright? Yes. Now let us discuss about the characteristics of acidity. So as we discussed before, acids are souring taste, and when it comes to the litmus paper test, they will come to a blue litmus to red litmus. If a litmus is changing its color from blue to red, it indicates that a particular substance is an acid. Okay, and coming to its physical state, few acids exist in solid state, for example, oxalic acid or boric acid, and few substances exist in liquids at the room temperature. For example, sulfuric acid, formic acid, all these exist in its liquid state at the room temperature. Alright, And coming to its electrical conductivity, yes, they are good conductors because, as I told you before, in the definition of acid, when you dissolve an acid in a water, it will produce H plus ions, right? And that will combine with water to produce hydronium ions. So basically, these ions are responsible for the conduction of electricity. Alright, and coming to the another character, yes, they are corrosive in nature. Suppose, you know, if some acids, if they fall on your skin, it will cause burning sensation or it might damage your skin completely. And if it falls on the clothes, it will, you know, start making holes in the clothes. So you have to be very careful when dealing with the acids. Alright, so now let us discuss about the classification of acids. So on the basis of origin, we have classified the acids into two types. One is organic acids, another one is mineral acids, or we also call it as inorganic acids. So organic acids are those which are derived from living organisms such as plants or animals. For example, citric acid, which is found in the citrus fruits, lemons, musambis, oranges, and oxalic acid. So these are the examples for organic acids. Okay, and coming to the mineral or inorganic acids, these are derived from the minerals. For example, HCl, hydrochloric acid, or sulfuric acid. So these are all the acids which are derived from the minerals. We call them as inorganic acids. So now coming to the second type of, or the on the basis of strength, we have classified the acids into two types. One being strong acids, the second one being weak acids. So strong acids are those which will disassociate completely to produce H plus ions when dissolved in water. For example, HCl, H2SO4. Like HCl, when you dissolve in water, will produce, it will disassociate into H plus and Cl minus, and here it will disassociate into 2H plus and SO4 minus ions, right? You can see they are disassociating completely, correct? Whereas in case of weak acids, they will not disassociate completely. So these are the acids which will partially disassociate in aqueous medium. For example, the acetic acid or formic acid. So these are all weak acids. Okay, and now coming to the third basis. So we have classified the acids on the basis of concentration as concentrated acid and dilute acid. The concentrated acids are those acids which have higher percentage of acids in the aqueous solution, whereas dilute acids are those acids which have lesser percentage of acids in the aqueous solution. Okay, so this is all about the classification of acids. So now let us discuss about chemical properties of acids in detail. The first property being reaction with metals. So now let us see how acids react with different metals. Okay, see, I have written a general equation of the reaction. So when metal reacts with an acid, it will produce its metal salts, respective metal salts, along with the liberation of hydrogen gas. I have written an example as well. You can see here, when magnesium reacts with HCl, hydrochloric acid, it is forming magnesium chloride salt along with the liberation of hydrogen gas, right? And also here you can see, when iron is going to react with H2SO4, sulfuric acid, you can see iron sulfate is being formed along with the liberation of hydrogen gas. So in general, what we can tell, when metal reacts with an acid, it produces respective metal salts along with the liberation of hydrogen gas. Correct? So I think you are already aware about this reactivity series, right? Based on the reactivity of metals, we have arranged them in the decreasing order of their reactivity, right? So here, potassium, sodium, calcium being highly reactive, we have kept them at the top of the series, and followed by magnesium, aluminium, zinc, iron, right? So it goes on like this. So here you can see the highly reactive metals will react you know, explosively with the dilute acids to produce its salt and hydrogen gas. So it goes on like this, and magnesium, aluminium, zinc and iron, they react with dilute acids with less vigor. I earlier only told you that, right? Based on their reactivity series only, we have arranged them in this order. And at last you can see, these are all very least reactive metals and they react with the concentrated acids. Alright, so that's all about a reaction with metals. So now let us discuss about how the metal carbonates or metal hydrogen carbonates are going to react with acids. Okay, you can see here again I have written a general equation for the reaction. When metal carbonate or metal hydrogen carbonate, when it reacts with an acid, it produces a spectrum metal salt along with the production of water as well as carbon dioxide gas. Okay, so you can see the examples as well, right? When sodium carbonate, right, metal carbonate, when it reacts with an acid, HCl, it produces a metal salt which is sodium chloride as a metal salt along with the formation of what? Water and carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide will be released in a gaseous state. And if you see here the second example, which is metal hydrogen carbonate. So you are taking calcium hydrogen carbonate. When it reacts with an acid HCl, it produces calcium chloride along with the formation of water as well as carbon dioxide. Correct? And see, we are considering another example where you are taking calcium carbonate and you are adding acid to it. So what is the product formed? Calcium chloride, it's a metal salt and the formation of water and carbon dioxide. So how do you test or how do you get to know whether the released has the CO2 or not? For that, if you, you know, perform a simple experiment, like when you pass that produced gas through the lime water, CaOH twice, it's nothing but calcium hydroxide, you will be obtaining calcium carbonates. It's a white precipitate, so the clear solution will turn out to be a milky solution because of the formation of this precipitate. Okay, and if you are passing excess of carbon dioxide, then what happens? You can see, if you are passing excess of carbon dioxide to this solution, okay, this solution, calcium hydrogen carbonate will be formed, but this is a soluble salt. Okay, so as this is soluble in water, the again the solution will turn to be clear. Okay, so this is how you can easily test for carbon dioxide gas. So now let us understand the another chemical property, which is what happens when metal oxides react with the acids. So you can clearly see that I have written a general equation again, that when metal oxides react with an acid, they produce the salt and water. Here are a few examples. You can see that copper oxide, which is an oxide of copper, when it reacts with acid, which is HCl, it produces copper chloride along with the formation of water, right? And also you can see here, when ZnO reacts with H2SO4 sulfuric acid, what it is producing? It is producing zinc sulfate. So zinc sulfate is nothing but salt and along with the formation of water, right? So now there is another property, that what happens when acid reacts with bases. In the introduction only I told you that acid and bases are totally, you know, they are chemically opposite in nature, so they will be neutralizing each other's effect. So when acid reacts with the bases, they will produce salt and water. For example, you can see here, when HCl is reacting with NaOH, what it is being produced, you can see NaCl, which is the salt, is being produced along with the formation of water. Correct? So if you see here, the both products are same, right? So even when metal oxide reacts with an acid or when base reacts with an acid, the products are same. So with this, we can easily conclude that all metal oxides are basic in nature. Okay. So I hope this is clear for you guys. So now let us discuss about uses of acids. I have written uses of few acids like hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid, NHNO3, nitric acid, acetic acid and carbonic acid. Let us discuss that. Alright, so HCl is mainly used in cleaning metallic items, tanning and in painting industries, whereas if you see the H2O is supposed sulfuric acid. It is used in fertilizers, the manufacture of fertilizers, chemicals, paints, dyes, explosives, plastic, synthetic fibers and many more. So because of all these things, no, this H2SO4, we call it as the king of chemicals. What do we call it as? We call it as the king of chemicals. And coming to nitric acid is also used in the manufacture of fertilizers, explosives, dyes and drugs. Okay. And coming to acetic acid, it's nothing but it is used as a vinegar in the cooking and mostly in food preservatives. And carbonic acid is mainly used in flavoring drinks. Okay, so these are all few uses of acids. So now let us discuss about bases in detail. What exactly bases are and their characteristics as well as their uses. Okay, so now coming to the bases, you can define bases are chemical compounds which when reacts with an acid, they are going to produce salt and water. Okay, this base could be oxides of metal or it could be hydroxides of metals. I have written a few examples. When it comes to oxides of metals, you can consider calcium oxide, zinc oxide, right? When our hydroxides, hydroxides means hydrogen oxides, OH. Right, OH ion should be present. So you can see here sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide, these are all the hydroxides of a metal. Okay, hydroxide of sodium and hydroxide of potassium. Correct. So you can see here also as well as right when calcium oxide is going to react with HCl, hydrochloric acid is going to produce what? Calcium chloride salt along with the formation of water. Here also you can see when NaOH is going to react with HCl, it is going to produce what? NaCl and along with the formation of water, again salt and water. Correct. So in this way, we can tell that bases are chemical compounds. When they react with acid, they are going to produce salt and water. But very often you would have been hearing the words alkalis and bases. So do you think both are same or both are different? So we should understand this now. Okay. See, bases, as I told you before, it could be the oxides or it could be hydroxides of a metal. Okay. But alkalis are those chemical compounds, or you can even call alkalis are bases, but when they dissolve in water, they will produce hydroxyl ions. Okay, see, all the bases which are not water soluble, they are not alkalis. You are understanding? So, all alkalis will produce what? OH. Right? Hydroxyl ions. So, with this you can clearly tell, is CO is a alkali? No, it cannot be alkali. It is just a base. Okay, so with this, you can clearly tell that all alkalis are bases, but all bases are not alkalis. Correct? So I hope you understood this. So now let us understand about the classification and uses of bases. So coming to the classification, we have divided bases into strong bases and weak bases. So strong bases are those which will disassociate completely into their ionic forms and produce a large or high percentage of hydroxyl ions when dissolved in water. For example, NaOH or KOH, okay, sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide are the examples for strong bases. So what happens is, the sodium hydroxide will completely disassociate into its ionic form like Na plus and OH minus. Okay, so you can see OH minus ion is being formed. Whereas weak bases will also produce OH minus, but they will not disassociate completely into their ionic form. Okay, thus they will end up forming a very less percentage or less concentration of hydroxyl ions. Okay, examples are ammonium hydroxide and calcium hydroxide. So these are all the examples for weak bases. So now coming to the uses of bases, you can see I have written a few bases like NaOH, KOH, calcium hydroxide, magnesium hydroxide, right? So here are the uses like that. So sodium hydroxide is mainly used in preparation of soap, paper, rayon, which is a synthetic fiber, and this is also called as caustic soda. But as I will see, the uses of caustic potash, nothing but potassium hydroxide, is also called as caustic potash. It is used in the manufacture of alkaline batteries, in the manufacture of soft soap, we use potassium hydroxide. So now coming to the uses of calcium hydroxide, we use that in the manufacture of bleaching powder, softening the hard water, and neutralizing acid in the soil. Okay, so basically pH maintenance of soil. For that purpose, we use calcium hydroxide. It is also called as slaked lime. Okay, and coming to magnesium hydroxide, which we already familiar with this, right? We also call it as a the milk of lime, because we use this as an antacid to neutralize the effect of gastritis or excess HCl acid or excess acid which is produced in the stomach. To neutralize that, we use antacids, and we also used to treat the digestion. So that's all about our bases. So now let us discuss about what do all acids and bases have in common. First, let us discuss about acids, then we will go for bases. Okay, so if we see this, when acids react with metals, they will produce metal salt along with liberation of hydrogen gas. So this one common character can be seen with all the acids. They will be releasing hydrogen gas when they react with the metals. Okay, and the second common character is that they produce hydrogen ions, or we also call them as hydronium ions, because these hydrogen ions will combine with the water molecules and they will produce hydronium ions. I will explain this later. So commonly all the acids will produce hydrogen ions when we dissolve them in water. You can see here HCl, when it is associated to H plus and Cl minus. As hydrogen ions cannot exist alone, they will combine with the water molecules and will form hydronium ion. Okay, same thing happens. You can see here with respect to nitric acid, here also it is disassociating into H plus and NO3 minus ions. And coming to H2SO4, you can see it is disassociating into 2H plus ions, right? Along with the formation of sulfate ion. Right, so like this. Acetic acid, you can see CH3COOH. So again here you can see the disassociation, but here it is partially disassociating, hence we call this as a weak acid. Whereas here you can see this is a complete disassociation, right, into its ionic form. Hence these are all strong acids. Okay, so with this we can conclude that all acids will be producing H plus ions. Later when they combine with water, it will form hydronium ions. So we also should understand that here you can see all these acids are containing hydrogen, right, in their compound. We also should understand that there are certain other compounds which contains hydrogen in them, but we do not call them as acids. So why it is so, we understand that. So now let us understand this experiment, and we can conclude that all the compounds which contain hydrogen cannot be called as acids. Because you can see here, in the first beaker, I have taken HCl, right? HCl, we are using it as an electrolyte. Okay, so there are certain compounds like glucose, alcohol, when we dissolve in water, they will not disassociate and they will not produce ions. So no ions means no conduction of electricity. So in this experiment, we are basically checking the conduction of electricity. So when I take HCl as an electrolyte, or when we take a solution of HCl, you can see H plus and Cl minus ions will be formed. Later it will combine with water molecules to produce what? Hydronium ions. So these ions will be responsible for the conduction of electricity. When you turn on the switch, you can see the bulb will be glowing here. Right. The same experiment, if we perform by taking glucose or alcohol, as they are not disassociating into their ions, so we cannot see the glowing of bulb or the conduction of electricity when we turn on the switch. Okay, so with this we can conclude that all the compounds, even though they contain hydrogen atom in their compound, we cannot call them as acids. So now coming to bases, what do all bases have in common? You can clearly tell by seeing these examples that you can see, right, sodium hydroxide, when they disassociate, they will form what? Na plus and OH minus ions. So similarly, potassium hydroxide will produce K plus and OH minus ions, right? And calcium hydroxide, you can see, again calcium and negative hydroxyl ion is being formed. So we can conclude that all bases will be producing hydroxyl ions in common, whereas acids, they will be producing H plus ions in common. Alright, so now let us discuss how acids and bases react in water solution. As we already know that acids, when we dissolve in water, they are going to produce H plus ions, and when bases, when we add it in water, they are going to produce OH minus ions, right? You can see, you can conclude that again by seeing these examples, seeing when HCl is dissolved in water, what it will produce? It produces H plus, and then later this H plus will combine with the water producing what? Hydronium, which is H2O plus ions, right? So that's the reason I have written here H3O plus and chlorine. Okay, chlorine ion. And with this NaOH, which is a base, you can see when we dissolve that in water, it produces Na plus and OH minus ions. Right. So with this, we can see neutralization reaction like this, right? See, acid will produce H plus is in common, and base will produce OH in common. So what we are doing? We can consider these two as a metallic ions, right? Because the salt will be formed here. So that we are representing it as MX. Okay, and then later H and OH. You can see H and OH we have represented here. So HOH is nothing but what? H2O. Correct? H plus and OH minus will form H2O, which is nothing but a water molecule. So this is nothing but what? Neutralization reaction. So now I hope you understood why water will be produced when acid and bases will react with each other. I was always telling you that they will cancel each other's effect, right? So how? It's because of this. Okay, so now actually the process of dissolving either acid or base in water is highly exothermic. It's totally exothermic. So care must be really taken while adding acid or concentrated acid or base in a water. Okay, so you can see I have written two ways, right? One way is that what do you think? Which way is correct? Either adding acid to an water or adding water to an acid. Which is correct, do you think? Yes, obviously this one is correct and this is totally wrong. Okay, you cannot do like this because as I told you before, the process of adding an acid or base to water is highly exothermic. So that's why when you start adding water directly to an acid or base which is highly concentrated, it produces enormous amount of energy, and because of that heat, this mixture can splash out and it can cause burns. Or sometimes because of the more heat which is being produced here, the beaker can also break, it can explode. Okay, so that's the reason, please do not do this. It's totally wrong, and you always should add acid drop by drop to this water with constant stirring. Okay, so this is a good way and the best way to add or to mix the acid with water or base with water. Okay, so yes, this is all about this concept. So now let us understand about indicators, its types. Okay, so coming to indicators, indicators are chemical substances that are added in a very small quantity to a solution to indicate whether a particular solution is acidic or basic in nature. Okay, So we have classified indicators into mainly three types. One, we call them as natural indicators. The second one is synthetic indicators. And the third one is olfactory indicators. Okay, so coming to natural indicators, those indicators are found in naturally. So usually they are plant-based, we call them as natural indicators. For example, litmus. Okay, so litmus is obtained from the lichens. It's a purple dye. Okay, so if we add this in our acid, it will convert a blue to a red solution. And if we add it in a base, it will turn red solution to a blue solution. So this is how, when it changes its colors, we'll get to know whether the particular solution is acidic or basic. Okay, and the synthetic indicators are those indicators which are not natural. So it has been synthesized, malmate. Okay, examples are methyl orange and phenolphthalein. And coming to olfactory indicators, these are the indicators which change their odor or smell in an acidic or basic medium. Okay, actually they can lose their when these olfactory indicators are added to particular acid or base solution or a base substance, they will change their odor or smell. They will lose their characteristic smell. Okay, so this is how we can exactly get to know whether a particular substance is an acid or base. So the examples are the onion extract, vanilla essence. These are all olfactory indicators that they will change their odor or smell when they come in contact or when they are treated with acid or base. Okay, so with all these indicators, it is clear that we will get to know if a particular substance is an acid or base. But do you think, can we really understand or can we really judge how strong an acid is or how strong a base is? Yes, we can do that with the help of a universal indicator. So this universal indicator is nothing but it's a mixture of several indicators. Okay, so what happens is usually this universal indicators will also change color at different concentration of hydrogen ions. So we will learn about this more with the help of pH scale. Yes, so pH scale is generally a scale which is used to measure the concentration of hydrogen ions in a solution. So P in pH refers to potence. Potence in German meaning power. Okay, so it's like you can consider as a power of hydrogen. Generally, we will be representing this pH scale. I mean, it ranges from 0 to 14, where 0 indicates it is highly acidic in nature, whereas 14 indicates it is highly basic in nature, whereas 7 indicates it is neutral in nature. Okay, so neutral means the concentration of H plus and OH minus ions both will be same. Okay, so as I told you before, 0 indicates it is highly acidic in nature. So higher the H plus ion concentration, lower will be the value in the pH scale. So if it is a strong acid, it will be having lesser pH value. You are getting? So here also you can see that I have indicated that the H plus ion concentration is more here, whereas when it starts going towards right hand side, the H plus ion concentration is decreasing, whereas the number is increasing, right? And here you can see 7. 7 means the concentration of H plus and OH minus ions will be seen. And more than 7, the solution or particular compound is told to be basic in nature, okay? Because here, after 7, the concentration of OH minus ions will increase, whereas the concentration of H plus ions will start decreasing. So the same thing I have indicated here, you can see here OH minus concentration is more than that of H plus ions concentration. So at 14, what it indicates? It clearly indicates you that the concentration of OH minus ions is more than that of H plus. As simple as that. So the neutral solution value will be 7, and for acidic solutions it will be lesser than 7, and for basic solutions it will be more than 7. So thus the strength of an acid or base depends on the concentration of H plus or OH minus ions that they are producing. Okay, so I hope you understood this topic. So now let us discuss about the importance of pH in everyday life. The first one being pH sensitivity in plants and animals. So the human body itself, our body works in a narrow range of pH value between 7 to 7.8. Whereas if you see the rainwater pH, like if it is below 5.6, you can call that as an acid rain. So when this water, when it combines with rivers, lakes or so, the aquatic organisms' life will really become difficult to survive there. So it's totally lethal for living organisms if the pH goes beyond 5.6. Okay, so now coming for the second point, which is pH of digestive system. As you know that our stomach produces HCl acid. So when it produces in excess, that person will have to suffer from gastritis, right? So again, you know the remedy as well, right? Either he or she will be suggested to take antacids or baking soda, correct? So that acid and base will cancel each other's effect. Right, so coming to the third point, which is pH and tooth decay. So usually what happens, the lesser the pH, the higher will be the chances of tooth decaying, because this pH of tooth should be maintained, it should be more than 5.5 always. If it goes below 5.5, it means you are in, the very extreme or pretty much good acidic environment is there, right? So that can be caused because if you are eating more sour or more sweet food and you are not brushing properly before you sleep or when you wake up, so the pH will increase. When pH of your tooth or teeth will increase, the enamel, right, which is present on your teeth, which is made up of calcium phosphate, starts getting corroded. Okay, so that's the reason you have to brush 2 times a day properly. Okay, to avoid this tooth decay, and you have to keep the pH of your mouth should be above 5.5 always. Okay, this the next one is the control of pH of soil. Yes, here also pH, in controlling the pH of soil for the proper growth of plants, this is very much required. See, certain plants, they need specific pH range in order to have a proper growth. So few soils will be acidic in nature, a few will be neutral and a few will be basic in nature. So if it is too acidic, they will treat that soil with lime, or if it is too basic, then they will add certain fertilizers which contains more acidic materials in them. Okay, this is how they will be balancing or controlling the pH of soil, so that plants will be having favorable pH value to have a normal or a proper growth. So next one is self-defense by animals or plants through chemicals. So everyone would have been experience of getting, bitten by some ants or, honeybee stings. So honeybee or ant stings, they are mainly made up of methanoic acid. So that's the reason we start getting, irritated or it starts paining also. That's because of the presence of methanoic acid. So again, this effect can also be neutralized when you, if you start just, rubbing that particular stung place with soap, which mainly contains base, and in which you feel relaxed or relieved from that pain. So this is all about pH, which we see to in our day-to-day life. So now let us discuss about salts in detail. So what are salts? Salts are nothing but, these are the ionic compounds which has a positive ion other than H plus and negative ions other than OH minus ions, and they are neutral in nature. Okay, so here you can see ionic compounds, which means they will be made up of ions. For example, sodium fluoride salt or copper sulfate salt or aluminium sulfate salt, if you are taking, when it gets disassociated, you can see it as being, disassociated into its ion. So Na plus and C minus. So the positive ion other than H plus, which is Na plus, and the negative ion other than OH plus,
hydroxyl, which is chlorine minus. So other than H plus and OH minus ions, salts will be having their respective anions and cations. So here also you can see copper plus and SO42 minus. That's the reason they are called ionic compounds, as they are made up of ions. So the next nature of the salts is, as I told you, they are neutral in nature. So neutral means what? If the charges are equal, like if the anion charge is equal to the cation, then a particular compound is said to be neutral in nature. So here also you can see number of positive ion is how much? 1. And here it is 1. So 1 is equals to 1, and hence NaCl is neutral in state. Okay. And if you see copper sulfate, what is the charge of copper 2 plus ion? It's 2. Right? Whereas if you see sulfate, again it is 2. 2 and 2 are equal. Hence copper sulfate is also neutral in nature. Like this, if you see here, you can see aluminium sulfate. Here you have 2 atoms of aluminium, whereas the charge of 1 aluminium ion is 3. Correct? So 3, 2. So 3 2s are 6. And here you can see the sulfate charge is what? It's 2, right? 2 minus. 2 minus, whereas you have 3 sulfate ions. So it is 3 2s are 6 again. So 6 positive charges are equal to 6 negative charges. Hence again it is equal in, I mean, neutral in nature. So thus all salts are neutral in nature, and you know they are produced by the neutralization reaction, correct? When acid and bases are treated, then a salt is obtained along with the formation of water. So this is how the salts can be prepared, and this is all about salts. So now let us understand more about its types. Okay, what exactly the family of salts mean, and then their properties. So now let us discuss about family of salts. So the salts which are having either positive or negative ion in common are said to belong to a same family of salts. Okay, so for example, you can see here I have listed down a few. Usually all the salts of HCl are told to be chlorides. We have this belong to a chloride family. And all the salts of H2SO4 are said to belong to sulfate family. And all the salts of HNO3 nitric acid will belong to nitrate family. So in all this, if you see chlorides, NaCl, sodium chloride or potassium chloride. So here what is common? Chloride, negative ion is common, right? Na plus Cl minus, K plus Cl minus. So Cl minus is common in both of them. So we will call these two as chlorides. Okay. And coming to sulfates, here you can see SO4 minus and SO42 minus. So both the sulfate or a negative ion is same. So that's the reason sodium sulfate and potassium sulfate will belong to sulfate family. And if you consider the third example where the nitrates, you can see again, right? Sodium nitrate and potassium nitrate, in both nitrate ion is common, right? So that's the reason these both will belong to nitrate family. So this is what if you see them horizontally. If you see vertically these examples, you can see Na, 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 right? All positive ions are common. So what I have told, either see positive or negative ions. So we can call again all these NaCl or Na2SO4 or NaNO3, they all belong to sodium salts. Okay, we can call them as sodium salts. And all these, right, you can see here potassium is common in all these three salts. So we can call them as they belong to potassium salts family. Okay, so this is all about family of salts. So now let us discuss quickly about classification of salts. Yes, so now we discuss about classification of salts. So mainly salts can be classified into three types. One being normal salts, the second one being acidic salts, and the third one being basic salts. Okay, so what are normal salts? The normal salts means if their pH value is equals to 7, then we can call them as normal salts. So how we can produce these normal salts is when we treat a strong acid with a strong base, then whatever the salt that we are going to obtain will be normal in nature or neutral also we can call, okay, neutral salt or a normal salt. So example, you can see HCl, you know, it's a strong acid, and sodium hydroxide, again you know that is a strong base. So when we treat this, we will be obtaining the NaCl, which is sodium chloride, which is a normal salt, okay, along with the production of water. So even if we are treating either strong acid strong base combination or weak acid and weak base combination, then whatever the salt is going to produce will be normal salt. So coming to acidic salts, acidic salts are those salts which have a pH value lesser than 7, okay. So these can be produced when we treat a strong acid with a weak base. For example, HCl is a strong acid. When we treat that with a weak base like ammonium hydroxide, we will obtain ammonium chloride, which is acidic in nature, and only the production of water, that is common, okay. So next, coming to basic salts, these are the salts which will be having a pH value greater than that of 7, okay. So this can be prepared by treating a weak acid with strong bases. For example, CH3COH is a weak acid. When we treat that with a strong base like sodium hydroxide, we will obtain this salt which is basic in nature, okay. And see, why this basic nature is because here you can see it is gonna retain, okay, when the salt formation happens, it will retain one ion from its basic parent. Okay, here sodium is being retained in the salt, hence it shows basic in nature. Okay, so this is all about classification of salts. So now let us discuss about properties of salts, then we will study in detail about few important salts. Yes, so these are all the important properties of salts. The first one is ionic compounds, which I already told, right? They dissociate into its respective, or they dissociate into their respective ions when we dissolve in water, right? So because of this property only, as they, you know, dissociate into their ionic forms, because of the production of ions in the aqueous medium, they will be able to conduct electricity. Okay, and they are soluble in water, and they will be having high melting and high boiling point. Usually the ionic bond will be very strong, so in order to break it, obviously the high temperature is required. So that's the reason they will be having usually high boiling points and high melting points. Okay, so these are the common properties of salts. So now let us discuss about some commercially important salts like sodium chloride, bleaching powder, sodium hydroxide, baking soda and washing soda. So the first one being NaCl, sodium chloride, which is also called as common salt or table salt, can be prepared by treating NaOH, which is sodium hydroxide, which is a strong base with a strong acid, nothing but HCl. Okay, so when we treat these two, we are going to obtain NaCl, which is neutral or normal. It's also a neutral salt. Its pH will be equal to 7 because both are strong base and strong acid. Okay, and along with the production of water. So this is the way in which NaCl can be prepared. So coming to its source, seawater is its main source, and also existing rocks. So that's the reason it is called as rock salt. Okay. So coming to the second important salt, which is calcium oxychloride. We also call it as a bleaching powder in common. So how we can prepare this calcium oxychloride is that you can pass the chlorine gas over slaked lime, which is calcium hydroxide. So then you will be able to obtain calcium oxychloride in all the formation of water. Okay, so this is being widely used as a bleaching agent in industries like textile, paper and jute industries. And also this bleaching powder, you know, it's a yellowish white powder. It will be used as disinfectant as well in order to kill the germs. It will be added in water to kill the germs, and it will make water as germ free. Okay, and the next one is, it is also used as an oxidizing agent in many industries. So this is all about NaCl and bleaching powder. Now we will discuss about NaOH, which is sodium hydroxide in tea. So now let us discuss about how NaOH, which is nothing but a sodium hydroxide, is also called as caustic soda, how it will be prepared. Okay, so this NaOH, which is a strong base, can be prepared by the passage of electric current through this brine solution. So what is this brine? Brine is nothing but it's an aqueous solution of sodium chloride. Okay, you know sodium chloride is a ionic salt. So it will disassociate into its ionic formula of Na plus and Cl minus in water, right? And meanwhile water also has, it will split into H plus and OH minus ions, right? So when it happens, you can see here the two electrodes are being connected to positive and negative terminal, right? The one which is connected to positive terminal, you call it as an anode, and the one which is being connected to a negative terminal, you call it as a cathode, right? So after this disassociation, you can clearly see that all positive ions are moving towards a negative terminal, right? They are moving towards what? The negative terminal. Correct? That's the rule. It's a principle. Unlike charges will attract each other. So that's the reason all positive, which are Na plus and H plus, are moving towards this negative terminal, which is nothing but a cathode. And at cathode, you can see H plus gas is being released. And at anode, what is happening? All negative ions are being attracted towards this anode. Correct. So that's the reason at anode, chlorine gas is being released. Okay. As the products being formed. Okay. And the left out thing is what? See, H plus hydrogen gas and Cl being chlorine gas. And you can see here Na and OH is being left out. So this is nothing but a sodium hydroxide, right? Na plus and OH minus. So the brine which is coming out of this container will be having sodium hydroxide. So this is how the sodium hydroxide will be prepared. See, you can see here why we call this as a chloralkali process, because you can see the products are chlorine and alkali, which is nothing but the NaOH. As the products being formed are alkali and chlorine, we call this method as chloralkali process. Okay, the same thing we can represent in the form of chemical equation like this. NaCl, right? When we treat with water, correct? And then we will pass in electricity, which will yield us NaOH, which is nothing but a sodium hydroxide, along with the liberation of chlorine and hydrogen at their respective electrodes. Understood? This is very simple, right? So, hope you understood this. Now, let us move on to the baking soda and its uses. So now let us discuss about NaOHCO3, which is also called as baking soda. Okay, so the chemical name of NaOHCO3 is sodium hydrogen carbonate. So in order to prepare sodium hydrogen carbonate, we will be using sodium chloride, water, carbon dioxide and ammonia as reactants, as raw materials. And then when these all react together, you will be obtaining ammonium chloride along with the formation of baking soda. Okay, this is how we will be producing or you will be obtaining the baking soda. So you will be getting, you'll get to see this baking soda in kitchen. Like our mom or your mom, they will be using this baking soda in order to prepare crispy pakoras and all, right? So this is what happens when it will be heated during cooking. When sodium hydrogen carbonate will be heated, it produces sodium carbonate along with the preparation or along with the liberation of what? Carbon dioxide. So actually this carbon dioxide, which will be produced during heating, is the only thing which will make the bread or the cake to rise, and it will make that particular food substance soft and spongy. Okay, and coming to its uses, yes, it is mainly used in the preparations of baking powder. The same reaction I have written, like baking powder is a mixture of this baking soda and some mild edible acids like tartaric acid. Okay, so baking soda plus mild edible tartaric acids, examples like tartaric acids, you will be able to obtain what? This baking powder. And coming to the another use, we will also use this baking soda in the preparation of antacids. You know the usage of antacids already, right? It is, as it is alkaline in nature, it will be used to treat the excess HCl or excess acid which is produced in the stomach. And the third usage is that it will also be used in the soda acid fire extinguishers. Okay, so this is all about baking soda. So now let us discuss about washing soda. So how it can be prepared? So the chemical formula of washing soda is Na2CO3 10H2O, which is hydrated sodium carbonate. So it can be easily prepared by heating sodium hydrogen carbonate and recrystallizing it. Okay, you can see here sodium hydrogen carbonate. When I heat it, I will be getting sodium carbonate along with formation of water and liberation of carbon dioxide. Then when I recrystallize it, okay, I will be getting the hydrated form of sodium carbonate. So this is nothing but we call it as a washing soda. So coming to its uses, we will be using this widely in the glass, soap and paper industries, and to manufacture the sodium components, compounds like borax, and it is also used as a cleansing agent, and also we use that to remove the permanent hardness of water. Okay, and you can see here 10H2O is associated with Na2CO3. So do you think this water molecules will make the salt white, or what exactly is this? So now let us discuss about the last concept of this chapter, which is water of crystallization. So what is water of crystallization? So it is nothing but that's a fixed number of H2O, nothing but the water molecules that are present in one forming unit of a salt. For example, you can see here copper sulfate 5H2O, it will be in blue color. So this is nothing but the hydrated salt we call. So this is nothing but the water of crystallization. So when we heat it, it will lose its water molecules which is associated with it. Okay, these water molecules will be loosely bonded to the salt, and upon heating, it will be losing this water molecules either partially or completely, and it becomes dehydrated. So that's the reason after heating, the blue color hydrated salt will turn out to be a white color unhydrated salt. Okay, so for example, I think with this you can answer for our last question, which is this washing soda. Do you think it is really wet now? No, it is not. Okay, it is just a hydrated salt. Okay, of sodium carbonate. So now we have another example like this. You can see here calcium sulfate is being associated with two molecules of water. So we call this as a gypsum. When we heat this gypsum, it will lose water molecules and it will be having only half water molecule. So that's the reason we call this as a calcium sulfate hemihydrate. As it is having half water molecule, we call it as a hemihydrate. So this is nothing but we call it as a plaster of Paris, the same plaster which doctors will be using in order to bind or to keep support during fracture. So this again, this is a white powder, and when this is again mixed with the water, it will again form a hard substance, gypsum. Okay, this is how it gives a solid mass to that fracture area. I hope you understood this concept of water of crystallization. If you have any doubts, please drop them in the comment section. Please do like, share and subscribe to our channel, and do not forget to click on the bell icon.